Blender physics system is known for its amazing fluid and cloth simulation, but what about rigid body simulation? And I won't be surprised if majority of Blender users hate it, cause sometimes it breaks, crashes, and doesn't work the way you intended it to. So to really test it, recently I made this animation which is fully rigid body controlled. The metallic ball falling, bucket catching and rotating cause of its weight, and again springing back up, all this motion is physics based. If you want to check out the video, its link is in the description below. Also, here are some other examples of rigid body simulation that I made. Each of these simulation only took me like 2 or 3 minutes to apply. These are all the things that you can do with just rigid body, and if you want to learn how to do it for free, then just keep watching this video. So it was all possible with the help of forbidden and mysterious option in the physics tab called rigid body constraint. We all have seen it, some of us have even dared to use it and might have failed miserably. So in this video you will learn about rigid body constraint and how to use them to create some great rigid body simulations. So get ready to learn something really incredible. Things to note before we start, rigid body constraint can only be applied between objects who are already rigid bodies. All the constraints have settings tab which has 3 checkboxes. First is enable, which allows user to turn that constraint on and off. Second is disable collisions. We are going to keep this checked or else simulation will be same as doing it without constraint, as it will start calculating collision between 2 constraint rigid body meshes. Third is breakable, which has a threshold of how much a constraint can sustain collision, and when it is beyond that limit, it will break that constraint. Breakable might stop Blender from crashing, but I'm just keeping it unchecked. You can find global rigid body settings in scene properties, where you will see collections, which holds all the rigid body objects in the scene, so do not remove it. Then in constraints, which holds all the constraint of the scene, also do not remove it. Speed is overall speed of simulation. Split impulse makes velocity to not go beyond a limit when 2 rigid bodies collide. Now, substeps per frame and solver iterations, both when increased will also increase the quality of simulation at the cost of more calculation time. I would rather keep both at 10, but if you really want to increase accuracy on certain parts, then you can do it locally as well. Select the constraint which you want to simulate more accurately. Go inside physics property, enable override iterations. This allows user to set custom number of iterations, as increasing them will give more accurate results on that constraint. But I will say don't turn it on unless you really need it. Now again, over global rigid body settings, we have cache tab, same as other things in Blender, allows to set simulation start and end frame. Here you can bake and delete rigid body simulation. Now let's start with the constraint and how to use them. Our first constraint type is fixed. With help of this constraint, you can attach 2 rigid bodies together without joining them. Now this is really handy when you wish to have 2 different values for both objects, for example mass, friction, bounciness, etc. But not only that, when you keep these objects separated, you can even use simple colliders like box and sphere, which are less expensive in comparison with mesh collider and convex hull. In this scene we have 2 spheres, both have rigid body on them with collision shape set to sphere. Now select the rigid body object which you want to attach to another rigid body object, in our case this sphere, and add rigid body constraint to it. Now keep type to fixed. Now in objects tab, sequence doesn't really matter, so I like to set first object constraint 1, then second object as to which we are constraining, and that's it. Now make sure you are at the starting frame, save the file and hit play to see your simulation. Awesome. Now there is really cool thing, if you place this smaller sphere inside the larger sphere and increase the mass on the smaller sphere, it will act as one of those dolls that stands right back up after you push them. And that's how you use fixed constraint. So next type is point. Just a note, while using point, I will suggest you to use empty to hold your constraint, because it is easier to move empty rather than moving origin of object. Now what point does is, It makes two connected rigid bodies free to pivot around the empty, which is holding that constraint. It does that while preserving all the initial rotation and distance between those two objects. In this scene, we have base cube, which is a passive rigid body, and a mid cube and last cube, which are active rigid bodies. By the way, these curves are not the part of simulation, they are just hooked to the faces of cubes. So hiding them or removing them won't affect the simulation. So first empty holds base and mid cube, sequence doesn't really matter. The second empty is actually parented to mid cube so that pivot point keeps updating with respect to it, and it holds mid cube and last cube. Now when I play this, you'll see how it's pivoting around empty. To show what I mean by preserving rotation, let me just rotate this last cube at a weird angle and hit play, and as you can see, it is preserving the initial rotation. So that's basically how you use point constraint. Next type is hinge. Hinge works exactly as it sounds. It makes object rotate around one specific axis, just like hinges works in real life. I will again suggest using arrow empties for this constraint, cause in Blender, hinges only works on local z-axis of the object on which that constraint is applied. So in our case, constraint is applied on these two empties. Now if you notice, empty is placed where I want point of rotation to be, and z-axis is pointing towards the required axis of rotation. Now the way I found out that hinge only works on local z-axis is by realizing I can only clamp z-angle inside angular tab of constraint. If you enable z-angle, then your object will only be able to rotate to a certain angle, which you specify here. Also, Z lower and upper depends on which direction your Z of empty is pointing. For example, in this scene, I could have also defined my axis of rotation like this. This still would work, but now you will have to change the Z lower and upper. So experiment with these two values until you get it right. Now inside constraint in objects tab, just select two rigid bodies which you want to join together as hinge. Sequence doesn't matter. Similarly, on the second empty, I have selected last two objects, and one thing to note, empty's position doesn't matter, it will work until it is pointing towards the axis of rotation. But now, if you wish to rotate the whole model, it's better to just parent empty to the object that you find suitable. So that's how to use hinge constraint. Next type is slider. As the name suggests, slider is used for sliding objects. In this scene, this small block is sliding inside this channel, which is totally physics based, as the actual moment is given by the disc over here. So except this base, everything you see is active rigid body. Also, this disc is keyframe animated, so in its rigid body settings, you have to turn on animated checkbox. Now as the disc rotates, it makes slider slide back and forth with the help of this rod. This first empty connects rod and disc together with the help of point constraint, and it is parented to rod. Second empty is parented to slider. You could also parent second empty to rod, but I choose parenting it to slider. Now rod and slider are connected together with the help of point constraint. This third empty is for slider constraint, and it holds slider and base together. Slider constraint only works on local x-axis, and a way to remember that is if you look at limits tab inside constraint, you can only clamp x-axis. So point x-axis of your empty towards the sliding direction. Position of empty doesn't really matter until x-axis is pointing towards the direction of sliding. But still, I will suggest keeping empty parented to a suitable object, mostly your slider. So that's how to use slider constraint. Pretty cool, right? Next type is piston. Piston constraint is similar to slider constraint, but in piston, your slider object can also rotate. So this simple scene consists of a base object, which is passive rigid body, and as it's keyframe animated, we will check the animated checkbox for it. These two blocks are passive rigid bodies, piston object is active rigid body, and this empty is parented to it. Now the local x-axis of this empty not only acts as direction of sliding, but also is the axis of rotation of piston. How to remember that? This empty has piston constraint. Inside the limits tab of this constraint, you can only clamp x angle and x distance. I have clamped piston to go from minus 10 degrees to 10 degrees angle wise and minus 2 to 2 in distance wise. And now in the objects tab, I have assigned base and piston. Again, sequence doesn't matter. Now let's play and see how it looks. It works as intended, but look what happens when I disable the linear clamp. Piston doesn't fall down. Also, if I disable the angular clamp, let's see what happens. Piston goes straight through cylinder. So that's it with piston constraint. Next type is generic. Generic is a constraint which allows user to clamp translation and rotation of any axis between two selected rigid bodies. Giving control of all axes make this constraint to be directly used on objects rather than using arrow empty. So depending on your need and condition, using or not using empty is your choice. In my case, however, the origin of handle is off the point where it should rotate, so I'm using empty. So this big cube is passive rigid body, handle is active rigid body, empty has generic constraint to it. This constraint is pretty big, but it's really simple if you know what you need. So in my case, I don't want this handle to rotate in Z and Y axis, and want it to freely rotate in X axis. For that, inside constraint, let's go into limits tab. Then go in angular and check Y angle and Z angle. Make it all zero. We left X axis unchecked, so it remains free to rotate. I also don't want my handle to move in any direction. So for that, just after angular, there is a linear tab. Open that, check all the axes and make their value zero as shown. In the objects tab, I have assigned big cube and handle. Assigning sequence doesn't matter. Now let's hit play and see it in action. So as we said, handle is not moving in any direction and is rotating freely on X axis. Great, so that's how generic constraint works. Next type is generic spring. As the name suggests, this constraint applies spring between two rigid bodies. And to make this easier to understand, let's hide this spring curve. Now the base cube is passive rigid body and above pad is active rigid body. There is an empty at the base which has generic spring constraint, and in the objects tab we have assigned pad and base for applying spring between them. Now there are two tabs, first is called limits, second is called springs. So in limits you can clamp both rotation and movement of spring in all axes, and springs tab is where you apply spring properties on one or multiple axes. Spring type, let's just keep it on 2.8. Now stiffness value, the more it is, the higher force it will take to deform the spring and vice versa. Dampening value, the smaller it is, the faster will spring get back to its original state after applied force is removed, and vice versa. Stiffness and dampening values depends on your scene scale, object scale, rigid body's mass, so you'll have to experiment with values that works for you. So I have turned on both angular and linear spring and gave them suitable values. Now I'll unhide the spring curve for better visual feedback of what's happening, and let's see it in action. Okay, that was really satisfying. Now let's disable the angular spring and see what happens. Okay, so spring just fell down. One could approach this problem in two ways, either by clamping it on all angular axes or give it both angular and linear spring. Also, best example for angular spring are torsional spring, and good example of linear springs are compression and extension spring. Now, I chose to have both angular and linear spring to tackle this problem instead of clamping is because the moment felt more realistic and organic with this approach. So keep a clear mind on what you need and go accordingly. Experimenting with this constraint is inevitable. Next and final type is motor. Normally, a motor would just make object rotate, but in Blender, they also gave option which applies velocity in one direction. Now that direction is local x-axis of object on which you applied the constraint. I will suggest you to use arrow empty as it is much more convenient and clean. So in first example, there is this motor body and this cylinder which are passive rigid bodies. Then this impeller and ball are active rigid bodies. So this empty is holding impeller and motor body together with the help of hinge constraint. This empty holds the motor constraint. So inside the objects tab, motor body and impeller are assigned. Sequence of assigning doesn't matter. Now to make impeller rotate, go to motor tab and enable angular checkbox. There are two values here. First is target velocity, which is the maximum angular velocity that can be achieved when motor rotates and won't go beyond that. Second is max impulse, which is like torque or power of rotation. To understand these values much better, let's have three cases. Case 1, we will set the target velocity to 1 and max impulse to 0 and hit play. As you can see, impeller keeps rotating freely cause of external force from ball, and as there is no power in impeller to resist that external force. Case 2, Now set target velocity to 0 and max impulse to 1. Let's play it, and as you can see, impeller stops even though ball had put good amount of force on it, cause target velocity is set to 0 and rotating would be going above that. Also, to prevent it from rotating, impeller had power in it. Case 3. Now let's make target velocity to 1 and max impulse to 1, 5 and 10 with it respectively. And as you can see, more the max impulse, the more the power and torque it has, which makes it not only to resist external force, but also make it move object with higher mass. For rotating motor in other direction, just make target velocity a negative value. Now the second example is for linear motor. This shaft is held by cube with the help of piston constraint, and I have limited shaft's movement. Also, do note that direction of linear movement is local x-axis. Cube is passive rigid body and shaft is active rigid body. So this empty holds motor constraint, and as explained earlier, target velocity and max impulse works the same here as well. Now I have animated the target velocity to go from 10 to minus 10 and gave cyclic modifier to its F curve so that it repeats itself. Also inside motor constraint in objects tab I have assigned cube and shaft, assigning sequence doesn't matter. Now let's hit play and see it in action. This to and fro motion is a bit boring, so let's add angular moment to it as well. For linear motor, this was the most basic example I was able to think about. That's it with all the rigid body constraint, which are seriously amazing, and I'm so curious to see what you all can make with it. Just tag Mr. Isometric on your Insta post, or if you upload it on YouTube, you can tag me there too. If you learned something from this video, do subscribe, like and share. It motivates and supports me to make more videos like this. Bye bye.